Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the First Congregational United Church of Christ in Elkhorn, Wisconsin. We are glad you are here with us, here in person, or watching us later in the day on our YouTube channel. We are thankful to have Reverend Kathleen Postel with us, and thank you to James for providing our music today. Please stand, if you are able, and join me in the call to worship. God, with expectation and faith, we come to worship you. David's words speak well for us. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. You desire honesty. Give me joy, my joy again. Our opening hymn, He Touched Me, page 564. Our opening prayer in unison. Happy are people of integrity, those who obey your decrees and search for you with all their hearts. They do not compromise with evil and walk only on your paths. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your principles. Help us, and loving God, to keep you deep in our hearts. Let our choices be according to your will. Amen.
Let's pray in the name of Jesus as he taught us to pray. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, for our children's time, is that Miss Bergen back there? I didn't see you. Hi. Well, Bergen, I got a question for you. You got to help me out here. All right, are you ready? You know, you can't hide back there. We got to have the full and total Bergen effect. All right. All right, here's the question, Bergen. What is it that you most enjoy drinking? Is it milk? Is it juice? Is it soda? Is it something I didn't think of? I couldn't hear you. Sparkling water. All right, sparkling water. All right, here we go. Now get ready. All right? God gives each of us a cup. You got a cup? And in your cup, you want to have sparkling water, right? All right. Now, you're walking down the street and you're so happy because you've got your full cup of sparkling water, right? And everybody else here has whatever they want in their cup, right? Well, here's what happened. You're in a big crowd of people and guess what happened? Somebody bangs into you and what happened? You're sparkling water does what? Spills all over, everywhere, right? Everywhere. Now, what happened? Why did that happen? Why did sparkling water fall out of your cup and coffee would have fallen out of mine? Okay? Why? Wrong. Wrong answer. That's what I thought too, by the way. Wrong. Do you know why sparkling water fell out of your cup and coffee fell out of my cup? And who knows what fell out of everybody else's cup, right? Do you know why? Because your cup had sparkling water in it and my cup had coffee in it. And if I had had toothpaste in it, the toothpaste would have fallen out, right? You see, God gives each one of us ourselves as a gift, just like you had that cup. But then along comes life, bam, and it knocks you into you. And you know what's going to spill out? Whatever you put inside. Now, what are some of the things you think we could put inside of our body, mind, soul, and spirit that when life hits us tough, it's going to come out? What do you think some of those things are? Kindness. Kindness, yeah, you've been practicing that for Lent, right? Kindness. What else? Oh, she's going to go right through the whole nine fruits of the Spirit. Go. Bergen, go. All right, so all the things of the fruits of the Spirit are going to come out if you've nurtured your Spirit of God in you and you've chosen to be filled with kindness and goodness and patience. And I'm not going to name all nine guys. Probably would forget. Bergen might remember. And what are some of the things we don't want to fill ourselves up with that I've been working on with you for Lent? Holding your tongue. So we don't want to fill ourselves with criticism, resentment, meanness, violent things. What else don't we want to fill ourselves with? Bitterness, resentment, loneliness, sadness, all the things that aren't going to make us live the life Jesus died for us to have. Do you know the word, Bergen, that Jesus said, I came to give you what kind of life? Do you have any idea what kind of life Jesus died on the cross and came to give us? It starts with an A. A-B-U-N. Abundant. An abundant life. And so that has to be filled with great things. All right, Bergen. Thanks for your help. Learn a lot today, will you? Oh, you need to know what's for next week. This week was what, Bergen? Huh? Biting your tongue. Did you get a hole in it? All right. So biting your tongue was what we were trying to do and not say things that were kind of mean in that. And next week, the big one, don't criticize. So all week, I want you to watch out about, you can bite your tongue again if you when feel like you're going to criticize, all right? All right, see you next week. Now, what about these big guys here? What are you working on for Lent? Have you been really on it? I slip around sometimes. You know, I make a great resolution, and then I say, oops, 3 days have gone by. You know what? Jesus knows us. Do you remember the gospel we had a few weeks ago that said, and Jesus knew what the people were like? That always, you know, that sounds kind of like, oh, man, he knows how we are. But on the other side of it, doesn't it make you feel good? It makes me feel good. Jesus knows I'm just a plain old human being, and I am going to screw up over and over and over no matter how hard I try, because I am human, and I have so many complex parts. We've got brains, and we got feelings, and we got thoughts, and we got, and so all of those moving parts, one of them backfires every once in a while, right? So it's nice to know that my Redeemer knows that I am human, and all of us are going to make mistakes. Now, I want to mention one thing about that song we sang, He Touched Me. That song means an awful lot to me. And it's because I had a dear friend who was a pastor. He was older than I was, and he was kind of a mentor and a guide. And when he retired, he would come to my church. And whenever he came, the people always asked him to sing He Touched Me, because he had this beautiful, deep, somebody over here has it too, a beautiful, resounding voice. And every time he came, and every time they asked him, and he always got up and sang it with joy. So I thought, oh, wow, that fits today. We need the Lord to touch us. Well, let's take a look at the reading. Now, before we start the reading, I need to tell you, I really had a time with it again. Man, I was like 4 days into it, and I'm going, I even read it to Ed. I said, Ed, something's not happening with this reading and I said, I get disconnected every time I read it. Well, finally, a couple days ago, I went and checked with another pastor to see what they thought. I thought maybe somebody knows a lot more than I do. And he had some insights, but it really didn't help me. So then I went to another translation. And I just read that last night. Wish I had read it before, because that gave me new insights. It just kind of phrased it in a different way. So here we go. I'm going to read it. See if you can find out what frustrated me. Now, here's what I want you to think about. Think about somebody comes to you and says, hey, I'd like you to meet Jesus. And I know you're a good friend, so will you take me there and introduce me? Now, think about you doing that, and this is the answer that Jesus gives. All right. Some Greeks had gone to, oh, by the way, it's from John, chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Some Greeks had gone to Jerusalem to worship during Passover. Philip, from Bethsaida in Galilee, was there too. So they went to him and said, sir, we would like to meet Jesus. So Philip told Andrew, and then the two of them went to Jesus and told him. And this is what Jesus said to these brand new people who wanted to meet him and his disciples. P.S. This was his final teaching. Trying to read it from the right translation. The time has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth for certain. Unless a grain of wheat is planted in the ground and dies, it remains a solitary seed. But when it is planted, it produces a death, and there will be a great harvest. The one who loves this life will lose it, and the one who gives it up in this world will have life eternal forevermore. Anyone who serves me must follow my path. Anyone who serves me will want to be where I am, and I will be honored by the Father. My spirit is low. I am deeply troubled. I'm unsettled and I'm confused. How can I ask the Father to save me from this hour when this hour is the purpose for which I've come into the world? But I say this for certain. Father, glorify your name. Suddenly a voice echoed from the heavens. I have glorified my name, and again I will bring glory in this hour that will resound throughout time. The crowd of people surrounding Jesus were confused. Some in the crowd said, it sounds like thunder. Others said, a heavenly messenger spoke to him. But Jesus said, the voice you hear has not spoken for my benefit, but for yours. Now judgment will come upon the world. Satan will be thrown out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, when I am lifted high over the earth, then all of humanity will be drawn to me. These words foreshadowed the nature of his death. I had a hard time. I mean, I would have expected Jesus to say, well, hello, it's really nice to meet you. My name is Jesus. How are you doing? But he tells this thing about a seed falling in the ground, and unless it dies and rises, and then him getting lifted up, and Satan is getting thrown out. And I just sat there and I said, how? How am I going to make sense of this for all my people? And then I said, God, you better do something. You got to get inside my brain and let me see what's really going on. Well, as I started researching and really realizing that this was the last public message that Jesus would give, one thing it said to me was, Jesus was in touch with what he was supposed to do. And although some newcomers were wanting to talk to him, he was set, man, like Flint. He was just, boom. I'm supposed to share this message with those people, all of them, and this is the message they are going to get. That says a lot to me. It says Jesus didn't care if they understood. God would work with them later. But he had to do what he had to do. He even says in there, you know, he kind of alludes to, I'd sure like to ask God to take this whole mess away from me. But that's what it came for. And he knew it. He knew it ahead of time. I mean, this is before Palm Sunday and the whole bit, you know? He knew it. I just can't even imagine living. I probably would have took off running if I knew what was coming at me. Do you know what I mean? And somehow Jesus was able to, one foot in front of the other. Reminds me of that time that Mother Teresa, some man, some businessman here from the United States called over to India. And never thought he'd really get her on the phone, right? So he calls over and he wants to make an appointment to come and see her. I probably told you, but it's one of my favorite things. It makes me, it helps me live. So he calls up and he said, hello, this is so-and-so and so-and-so, a pretty fancy guy. He said, could you make an appointment with me for Mother Teresa? Well, just a minute, I'll get her. So whoever answered the phone went over and got her. He said, well, I didn't expect to speak to you. Your secretary would have been fine, but this is really cool. How are you doing? She said, I'm fine. He said, well, I want to make an appointment to come and see you on this date at this time, and I'll be there. She said, well, good. She said, I'll put you on the schedule, but you need to know who my boss is. My boss is the Holy Spirit. And if the Holy Spirit needs me someplace else, you can be here, but I won't be, so take your chances. And I thought, wow. Well, I suppose if you're Mother Teresa, you can say that. But you know what? I think God wants us to be able to say that too. And not hop to it every time somebody wants us to hop to it. Not that we can't be kind and loving and do, but have you ever hopped to it and then regretted doing it? I think the biggest hop to it I did was I was working. I taught school all day, but I worked at night. I was trying to save money for grad school. And, well, I had my master's, but I was trying to go, I wanted a doctorate since I was a baby, I think. So anyway, at 78, 25 and 40 was a baby, right? So anyway, what happened was, I was working this second job after I taught all day. I didn't work it every night, but this one night, one of the people that worked it needed somebody to fill in. And it wasn't my night to work. But I said, okay, I'll cover for you. So I went and worked. My dad was in the hospital, but my dad was in the hospital a lot. And so I asked the doctor before I said I'd take that shift, and the doctor said, you know how this is. There's no way anybody can tell you anything. But just having seen him, odds are he's going to be okay. So I went to work. I worked all night, got a phone call. Your dad is getting really bad. And I went out. I said, I got to go. That's it, guys. I know you can handle the rest of the night. And I ran out to my car, and it wouldn't start. So I called the service, and they didn't come. So I had one of the other people working there take me home. I didn't live very far, but take me home, and then I can get my last car, go to the hospital. By the time I got home, for the first time in years, my mother, my brother, and I were all in the house at the same time. And the phone rang and told us that Dad died. Now, would I have gotten there in time? Would I have, whatever? Would I have just been there sitting at the hospital? Would it have made any difference? Who knows? But it's an example of, I don't remember, of course I don't remember a lot of things, but I don't remember praying before I made that decision. You might say, well, you don't pray every time you get a glass of water, do you? Well, no, but maybe bigger decisions I need to remember to pray. I can tell you, this thought shot through my mind when I was going through a child custody deal, and I was sitting in the courthouse, and my ex-husband and the woman he married were sitting over here with my two kids. You heard me, my two kids, not our two kids, my two kids. And they kind of look a little like me, but the woman he was with is similar to looking like me too, believe it or not. So anyway, I'm sitting on a bench over here by myself, cooling my heels, waiting for somebody, the lawyers or somebody. And there was an African-American woman sitting next to me. And she said to me, I know you guys must think I'm making this stuff up. It's true. I'm telling you it's true. She said to me, you know, those are your girls over there, aren't they? I thought, yep, they sure are. Well,
I got a message for you from God. And I thought, good night, sweet mother. What? She said, yeah, well, I'm telling you. I said, okay, let me have it. Get ready. Now, I'm expecting, you know, you're going to win the kids and everything's going to be great and life's going to go on and you're going to have a lot of money and you're going to be... You want to know what the message was? Get ready for this. Be sure you pray before you make a decision. I thought, well, that's a no-brainer. Well, maybe it is a no-brainer, but how many times did I not do that when I should have? I think she could have added, and after God speaks to you, listen, right? But the whole thing was, and I thought, well, man, I was expecting a great message. And do you know what happened? I said, I don't even have any decisions I have to make today anyway, so there. Do you know, within 10 minutes, I got dragged into an office, and my lawyer came at me and said, now you've got to make a decision right now. They want to know whatever. Honest truth. I looked him in the eye and started crying and said, I'm not making any decisions till I pray about it. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? And I guess I never would have had, at that stage in my life, I wouldn't have had enough gumption to stand up to a flea. Let alone look at this scary lawyer and tell him, I'm not making any decisions till I pray. I'm telling you, guys, if you truly try to follow God, you will be overwhelmed with the craziness. It's really wonderful. It's really wonderful. Well, how did you feel about this gospel? Did you kind of feel anything like I did? Like, it really wasn't an expected message to give to two brand new introduction people, was it? I mean, tell me I'm okay. Tell me. Okay. So anyway, as I researched it a little, and I didn't want to research it a lot because I wanted the message to speak to me and not some scholar. But the biggest thing that helped me was realizing that Jesus knew that he was on a schedule now. He needed to be going according to what he knew he was supposed to do. And it was not to socially greet these people. It was to get this important message out to all. Because remember, the Greeks weren't the only ones that were there. There were a whole lot of people. And so this message was very important. Well, what did this message have to do with you and me? How did it help us to hear this? Well, one thing it helped me with was hearing Jesus say, I am really low. My spirit is really low. I'm deeply troubled, was what he was saying. That helps me. I mean, if Jesus was deeply troubled, I guess that's just part of the gig, huh? We all are going to have times when we're deeply troubled. We're all going to have times when we don't know what to say. One translation said, I'm confused. The other one said, I don't know what to say. It helps me every time I realize that Jesus does know what we feel. He does. Now, the thing about that I didn't like was one translation said, and you have to despise your life here in this world. I thought, no way. I kind of like my life. I'm not going to despise it. But I liked the other translation said, you need to give up your life in this world if you're going to have eternal life. I understand that. I understand giving up your life. There's days, I'm going to be honest with you, there's days when I would like to be traveling and going over to Europe and doing anything. Do you know? I was over in Florence and I was the only one that said, I told the travel guide, he says, does anybody want to climb the 116 steps that go up into this tower so you can see the whole city? And all of them said no. I said, well, which direction are you going? Because I'm going to go. So he said, we're going to go this way for a while. You'll have about a half hour. I said, okay, see you later. And I took off the other way, and I climbed. Boy, when I got to the top, I understood why they didn't want to do it. But it was beautiful. It was a beautiful view. You know, I love life. I'd like to go on a cruise. I really would. I love water. I like to eat. And I like shows, and I like all that stuff. So do you think, with my husband being extremely ill, do you think that is in my near future? Or do you think maybe God's calling me right now to give up that part of life? Kind of feel like it. Now, do you think that I cry every day because I'm not going to Europe or on a cruise? Nah, I've been around the world. I'm happy. God knew what my future was, and he gave me the greatest life I could have. Well, there's a few parts I would have left out, but anyway. So, what I'm trying to say is, God does have plans for us. And just like we talked about filling our cup, God does give us a beautiful life. But what are you going to fill it with? And if you get bumped into, what's going to spill out of you? I think we could use the rest of Lent to really consciously want to fill ourselves with things that if we get bumped into, it's okay that they spill out. Now, I need to tell you another way that God's working. God's working overtime in my life. Overtime. My husband is bad. Okay? I got to admit that. He breathes really shallow now. Has no energy at all. He's trying his very best to eat and to drink. But I never knew when I was here standing last week that I was going to spend 7 days driving back and forth to Milwaukee. Okay? He's thrilled to be home, but I'm sad because just yesterday he went to move and he let out a scream. I've been with him 33 years. He has never screamed in pain in his life. And he's had pain the whole time. So this had to have been really, really bad. Well, I got to tell you how God worked, though. Like this to me is a miracle. If any of you know, when you have someone who's totally paralyzed and you're my size, even if you were bigger than me, it's very hard to move dead weight. So we have a rail system with a lift on it, and it's a piece of cake, right? Piece of cake if, big if, the person is not in excruciating pain, because he was in the bed. In order to get him out of the bed, you have to roll him to their side. And then you put down a sling, and then you roll him to the other side, and then you pull out the sling, and then you hook it up and lift him up. Well, that always works when he's not in pain. But when he is in excruciating pain and you can't touch his shoulders or his back or his muscles, and he still wants in his chair, not in the bed, how am I going to do that? Well, I tried really hard, and I got him all dressed, and I was all ready to get him into the chair, and guess what I forgot to put on? The sling. I've got them all ready to go, but I don't have a sling on. And I can't move them. Well, we have two slings. So, this is God, not me. I'm telling you, I'm not that smart. All right? But I hooked up the one sling to the lift and lifted his feet up. Then I was able to put it up to his waist. Then I put him back down. Then I put the bed up. I said, Ed, this is going to hurt, but it's the only way we're going to get you out of bed. And I kind of pushed him forward a little and shoved the other sling from his head to his waist. I've never done that before, and I don't think that the medical teams would allow it, all right? But I was desperate. I didn't know what to do. So I said, okay, God, we got two slings on, one on a head and one on a butt. Now what? So I start to get him going up, and he's going like this, and he's going, ah! I said, down again. I said, okay, God, now what? Now what am I going to do? How am I going to get him out of bed? And the idea came to me to tie the two slings together and treat him like one. And I did. And I was able to get him up and over and down into the chair, and he spent the rest of the night, not painless, but he spent the rest of the night able to watch television, able to sit up like a human being, able to eat his dinner. Do you know what I'm saying? Only by the grace of God. And when you're panicked, to be able to think and come up with a new idea, only by the grace of God, I'm telling you. So I'd like to have you, when you go out today, you're going to have somebody bumping into you. I know it. Life is going to jolt you. I don't know how, but I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, you're going to get jolted. Remember the lady that gave me the message. Remember the fact that in an emergency, I was able to pull off something that in a sane moment, I probably never would have had the creativity to come up with. Your God is right there for you, no matter what it is. And today I was supposed to speak about forgiveness. And the biggest thing that God told me was, remind them, forgiveness is a process. Yes, they can choose to forgive. And they're going to get angry and mean over it again. I'll give them 10 minutes. And it's true, isn't it? But the point is, forgiveness is a process, and you need to choose to forgive. For the person that hurt you so terribly, no. For you. So that you can be free. So that you can grab that life I told Bergen about. Jesus came and said, I came that they will have life and life abundant. That means free. Free of guilt. Free of problems. Free of worry, free of whatever it is that's going on in you right now. Why? So that you can feel the joy that comes from God. So that you can feel the trust and the power of God. In closing, I'd ask you to please pray for me this week. Pray that I can get it up to the doctor, that they can do something with that pain. No one should suffer like that. But I also want to tell you that I had a message from the church that I went to before I came here. And they sent me this thing for Easter. And it said, one of the hardest things is to walk with someone you love when the pain is excruciating, as Mary and the other women walked with Jesus. So realize whatever you go through that is painful, you are really walking with Mary and the other people that walked with Jesus through his excruciating pain. Amen. You know, we switched the silent prayer and the pastoral prayer so that after I get through being so excited and sharing with whatever it is I'm sharing with you, I can sit down and get it together for a minute and then come up and pray. And as I was sitting there ready to pray with you and give you a pastoral prayer, this is what came to me. Spirit of the living God,
fall afresh on them. Fill them, mold them, use them. May the God who fills you and loves you, may that God richly bless you every day of this week. Amen. Our closing hymn is the song On Eagle's Wings.
Thanks to all of you for joining us in person and online for worship. If you missed any of our earlier worship services, they are available on your YouTube channel. You can find a link to our channel along with other information of our church by going on our website, elkhornucc.org. For the season of Lent, the church, we are collecting items for the Elkhorn Food Pantry. Today, we are collecting peanut butter and jelly. Thank you for all your donations. There will be a Monday service recording available to you to view on YouTube on Thursday afternoon, March 20th. Thank you to the confirmation class for creating this presentation. You are invited to attend our Good Friday service and meditation on March 29th from 12 to 3 p.m. Pastor Kathleen will be reading scripture every 30 minutes, allowing for meditation in between the readings. You may stay for 30 minutes, an hour, or as long as you need. If you wish to purchase a flower to help decorate the church for Easter, there is a sign-up sheet on the table in the back of the sanctuary. Easter lilies, daffodils, tulips, and hyacinths are $15 for each plant. Checks should be made out to Jean Lyle. Please place your order today. You are welcome to join us in the family room after worship for coffee fellowship today. Thank you to Catherine Turk for hosting. And as always, please consider the ministries of our congregation with your financial gifts. There are offering plates in the back of the sanctuary, as well as a PayPal tab on your church website. We appreciate all of your gifts. Thanks again for sharing in our worship service.
First, I'd like to thank all the people that are filling up our bulletin board over here with thoughts that they get when they read the scripture. You should have a little piece of paper inside of your bulletin and has lines on it so that you can read and think and share with us, if you will. The blessing today. Oh, gracious God, I ask you to let each person here feel that they truly are in the palm of your hand, that they are safe and secure, that there is nothing that they want or need that you won't provide. Help us, Lord. You created us and you know how easy it is for us to get afraid or to get angry or to get somehow. We ask your peace to fill us and truly let us know we are held in the palm of your hand. Amen.
Again, we keep this solemn fast, a gift of faith from ages past. This Lent which binds us lovingly to faith and hope and charity. The law and prophets from of old in figured ways this Lent foretold, which Christ all ages sovereign guide in these last days has sanctified. More sparing, therefore, let us make the words we speak, the food we take, our sleep, our laughter, every sense, learn peace from holy penitence. Let us avoid each harmful way that lures the careless mind astray. By watchful prayer, our spirits free from scheming of the enemy. We pray, O blessed three in one, our God, while endless ages run, that this our Lent of 40 days may bring us growth and give you praise.